Beside being the historic little giant of jazz, Johnny Griffin was the best storyteller ever. Recording at least 50 albums that I could count and playing countless gigs, he could have filled a book with stories about himself. But most of the stories he told were about others, those he loved playing with, like Thelonious Monk Art Blakey, and the tale we're about to hear, legendary Rahsaan Roland Kirk. Though saxophonist Roland Kirk was known for blowing two or three instruments at a time, some of his own invention like the manzella, it was his heart and soulful purpose which touched others and allowed him to create a body of work that stands shoulder to shoulder with any artist.
Tell me about your first contact with Rahsaan.
Yeah, it was really something. The exact date, it must have been 1955. In Chicago. In Chicago, we had what we call Blue Monday morning jam sessions. It would start at 7:30 in the morning on Monday mornings. This is after the big nightclubs would close, like the Club de Lisa, the El Grotto, or the Rum Boogie. These clubs that are not there anymore would close, and people would have a little breakfast. They would close like 4 o'clock in the morning. People would have a little breakfast. And then had clubs that would start all over again. Now, we worked in these clubs at night. This club was called the Flame Show Bar.
Where was that located, on the south side? Or?
It was on the south side, right off the lakefront, on Oakwood Boulevard, part of the Macomba Hotel. I met everybody. I met not only Rahsaan, that's where I met Cannonball and Ned Adderley there also. But speaking about Rahsaan, the club was full of entertainers, you know, dancers and musicians and night people. And the session would start and it would last all day Monday, all night Monday night into Tuesday morning.
I don't know how they could stay up that long.
Oh, well, you know, night people had that facility for staying up. Besides, the music was very interesting because, I mean, everybody would come and play, you know. This particular morning, at this particular time, I was working like 7 nights a week. Matinee on Sundays from 3 to 7. And in Chicago, you work at night, you'd work, the hours would be like 10 to 4 in the morning. And Saturday nights would be 10 to 5. And the matinee on Sunday, 3 to 7, start again, 10 to 4. And have a 3.5 hour break and hit again at 7:30. So you know I was out of my mind completely. Being that I always had a great thirst for alcoholic beverages at this particular time. So you can imagine, I don't know exactly what time it was, could have been 10 o'clock or whatever. Anyway, the bandstand would say about 5 feet off of the floor, behind the bar, circular bandstand, long bar, club is long. And it's about, if you can imagine, about 20 yards from the front door, maybe 25 yards from the front door, as I could see the front door, people going in and out. And that was another entrance going into the hotel, too. And then another entrance going into the place where they sold fried chicken wings and chicken livers and stuff. So, I mean, it's plenty of eating and drinking and merriment all the time. You know, and out of this haze of smoke and being completely out of my head, I look down and I see him leading this blind man in the front door. I'm playing, you know, cats are swinging, everybody's dancing, talking, having a good time. And I see this blind man has a golf bag over his back with these funny-looking instruments sticking out of it. I mean, from where I was standing, and I'm nearsighted anyway, and I don't play with glasses on. I mean, it looked like he had a bag full of Halloween horns or something, you know, I didn't know what. You know, so I told him to take him into the band room, you know, so we had intermission. And I went into the band room. He was in there. We were introduced. And I asked him what were, you know, these instruments. I mean, when he pulled them out, I could see they were not Halloween horns. I mean, you know. But the shapes of them were like straight soprano saxophones in that sense, you know. And I asked him, what's the name of this one? He told me it was a Stritch. I said, Stritch? Stritch? And I'd been playing it myself for, I'd been playing professionally then, as if I was in the 50s. I'd been playing at least 20 years or more then.
Do you make them?
I mean, not 20 years, but maybe 12. I mean, it was, say, 55, 56. I'd been playing since 1943 professionally. And then I said, what was that other one? He said it was a Monzella. Monzello or Monzella. I said, what? You know. And then he had a ton of saxophones and some other strange things. He was hanging around his neck, flutes and stuff. I said, okay. So I invited him up to bandstand to play. And we helped him up because it was kind of dangerous getting on this stand. It was just a little weird little staircase going up. Not a real staircase, but more or less like a ladder, so you'd really climb, you know. So anyway, we got him up there. And we started to play. I don't know what tune it was. Probably some blues or something. Started swinging something. I took the first solo. People enjoying it. I'm swinging. I'm feeling good. Okay. I finished. People applauded. You know, blah blah blah. And he started to play his tenor saxophone. And I was listening. I said, "Oh, this guy's good. You know, he can play." I look at it in another direction, clapping my hands as I usually do on the stage, you know, feeling good. I don't know, and after about 2 or 3 minutes of his playing, I'm still looking in another direction. I heard 2 more horns come in, playing background to his tenor saxophone solo. So naturally, I turned around to see what's going on, because we were the only 2 horns on the bandstand, only 2 cats playing. You know, and I was so surprised when I turned around to find Roland. You called him Rassan, I always called him Roland. Playing background to his own tenor saxophone solo, which really struck me almost dumbfounded. I mean, I never experienced anything like that. I thought I'd seen everything, you know. I mean, so I immediately got on off the bandstand and stood there off to the side to see what was going on, because I'd never witnessed anything like this before. This is the way I met Roland Kirk.
Saxophone?
Yeah, he could do that. He stopped playing his tenor, then he'd pick up these 2 other horns and play some black background. Then grab his tenor and play again. Then he'd stick all 3 horns in his mouth and play a phrase with 3 notes in it, you know. I mean, really, that just turned me upside down. I couldn't believe it.
I just think all the people have hard enough time when they first pick up the saxophone, just to see what it's like to blow a saxophone.
Oh, definitely. But you know, this man was so powerful.
God.
And so strong. I mean, really, physically. Strong, yeah. I mean, I arrived one time in upstate New York. I forget if it was Rochester or where. And I was following him on a gig then. He had played it. I think it was a place where the John Hendricks family had a place up there, a coffee bar, like. And I got there the day after he had finished. And he was on the front page of the newspaper there. It seemed as though a taxi cab driver was taking him to the airport and tried to cheat him or something. And having to touch him, grab Roland or something. And of course, he was in immediate physical danger with Roland. And so the man went and called the police, and then 2 policemen came. And as I understood it, Roland did damage to the 2 policemen plus the taxi driver also.
Yeah,
and so they finally arrested him, you know. And when the judge found out that he was blind, you know, he didn't know, he was flabbergasted, he didn't know what to, you know. But Roland, of course, I mean, because Roland was always a fair person and beautiful. So I don't know exactly what happened, but anyway, the judge let him go because he had a gig in California. The next day or something, he had to leave, but he told him, don't come back here to Rochester. But, I mean, just to show his physical strength, I mean, any time you think that a man can play three instruments, fill it up, three saxophones, you know, with one pair of lungs, I mean, wow.
And one mouth. How he could create that back?
I have no idea. You know, that was when I just met him, and I knew him forever, for a long time. I played many gigs with him after that, you know. I mean, I played gigs with him. He's come on my gig with Tete, the blind Catalan pianist. Once I remember in Berlin, I was working in a club, and they had this festival there. Coleman Hawkins, Dan Train, and Elvin, and Miles, man. They all came in this club where I was working with Arthur Taylor, the drummer, and the French contrabassist, Albie Culas. And Roland and Tete came in and to jam with me. While we were playing, Roland asked me to get behind him and finger his tenor saxophone while he fingered these other two instruments. And I'm standing behind him, fingering his tenor saxophone, and he's fingering his other two horns, but he's blowing all three of them. Now, can you imagine that?
How did the other musicians take him? I mean, you know, they must have been a little bit put off. But
some musicians didn't like him at all. Some musicians did not like him at all. Some well-known musicians did not like him at all. Because they felt like he was stealing the show. Some of them felt that he wasn't authentic.
They think he was showboating or something.
Of course, sure. You know. And so some people just couldn't see beyond his ability to. They couldn't see it because he could do that, to play these three instruments at once. They just refused to accept this as being something extraordinary.
How did he talk about his music?
He never talked about any music, you know. Mm-mm. Not with me. I always had fun with him. Yeah. He was a friend of mine.
What was he like as a person? I mean,
beautiful. Very simple. I mean, very humorous. I found it very easy to get along with.
He seemed like a great, also, you know, one of the aspects about him is he seemed like he could do just about anything, any kind of style, and he seemed like a great historian of people who have come before him. He would all of a sudden play like, you know, mention somebody he was going to play like and say, this is what this guy did, you know, this is where it came from.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he had that ability, of course. By being blind, he also, his sensitiveness, hearing, was probably expanded to a degree much beyond ours, the people that can see. So he had that ability. But I mean, you know, he was just full of natural talent, though, the man.
Yeah, everything I heard him play, all of a sudden, the first time in my life, I heard him play harmonica on the screen.
Yeah, anything, he'd do anything, pick up anything, you know.
This crazy cut in which he had Paul Ropes in the beginning of it, you know, it's crazy.
He'd do anything that would catch his fancy, his imagination would grasp. He was like that, very outgoing. And then at the same time, I never found him to be an introvert. He was always very open and out and laughing. And wanted people around him to have a good time. Very independent. He didn't want you to help him very much. He could find his way around. He was, you know, he was nobody's baby. He was a man. And he'd let you know that quickly.
Thank you.
out on that, he was always a person that was always trying to help other people. This is something Roland always had. He always had it in himself, because he had such an abundance of spirit and strength that he was always trying to get audiences or even people one-on-one to feel better. That was his thing, to feel good and to feel better. You know, so he had this, just like I said, he had an overabundance of this spirit in him, that it was completely infect any audience or anybody, whether he was playing or not, just being in his company. You could feel the positive vibrations emanating from this person.
When was the last time you saw him?
Let me see, when was the last time that I saw him? Oh, God. I think the last time I saw him was in the 60s. We were on tour together in Europe, because I was living in Europe. Yeah, but we spoke on the telephone many times, and he sent me his albums, you know, because I have a whole big record collection of his.
If we could play something right now, let's say it's one or two songs by him, that are, say, favorites of yours.
You know, like you said before, you know, there's so much sincerity in the man, and almost anything that he plays was there, because you could feel it automatically. And that was the beauty of this person, of Rasan.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Thank you.
That was Once in a While from Roland Kirk's Rip, Rig, and Panic album, featuring Roland Kirk on saxophone, Jackie Byrd on piano, Richard Davis on bass, and Elvin Jones on drums. Recorded by Rudy Van Gelder in 1965.